So, you want to go faster on your bike and you're looking for aero gains. For example, a time trial handlebar, like this time zone bar from Controltech, or maybe new wheels, or an aero helmet, or a new position. But how do you know if it's actually faster rather than just feeling faster? Well, here at GCN, we love to talk about science. We even sometimes do proper experiments, and oh, how we love to quote peer-reviewed research from scientific journals. But the problem is that the results we get in experiments might not be relevant to you. It's normally very case-specific, especially for aerodynamics. If you want to test what's really faster for you, then you'd need to go to a wind tunnel, which is quite expensive, or you could do a really good field test. So here is GCN's guide to how to do a really good field test to test for aero improvements. First of all, let's talk about input variables and response variables. That's kind of a fancy way of saying that you need to change something and measure something. So the thing you're changing is what is going to hopefully bring you an aerodynamic improvement, and the thing you're measuring is probably going to be whether you go faster or not. So in our example, what I'm going to change is the angle on these Controltech aero bars from 0 degrees, where they are at the moment, to 5 degrees. And that might sound like a tiny, tiny change, but it actually is exactly the kind of thing that we would have measured in a wind tunnel the year before an Olympic Games with British cycling to see if it brought any benefits. In fact, we would have measured even smaller changes than that. Now, the test I'm going to use is a time trial effort on this 1 kilometer stretch of straight road, and the response variable is going to be whether I go any faster. The key things you want to pay attention to when designing an experiment are validity, repeatability, reliability, and measurement. Or should that be measurability? Internal experimental validity means quite simply making sure that you are measuring what you want to measure and not something else instead. It requires you to make sure your experiment is consistent. So you just have to think quite carefully about other factors that might influence the output apart from the different input variables, like in my case, the bar angle. So right now I'm thinking about all the possible reasons that I might go faster on my time trial stretch of road that aren't due to being more aerodynamic. For example, if one time I put down 50 watts more than another time, then I'll probably go faster, but it won't be due to changing the angle of the bars. So basically what you need to do is think about keeping all the variables constant apart from the one variable that you're changing. And this is also known as local control. Local control means trying to remove all other influences on your experiment beyond the one variable you are deliberately changing. For example, the variables you don't want to change are wind conditions and temperature, so do all your tests on the same day if possible and in calm conditions. The power you exert, traffic, fatigue, tire pressure, body position, the total weight of your bike, the total weight of you and your clothing, and so on. So to put it another way, you only want to change one variable at a time, and that does include weight. So if, for example, I was to go and have lunch mid-experiment, well, that would change my weight and that would influence the result. So no lunch stops, no coffee stops, and for that matter, no pee stops either mid-experiment. And if the variable you are changing on your bike changes the weight of the bike, for example, if you go from low pro wheels to deep section wheels, then you need to compensate for that weight difference. For example, what you can do is have a bead on for both setups, but with more water for the lower weight setup of your bike. So for my experiment today, I've chosen a route with no traffic lights, no corners, and not too much traffic either. There is a bit of wind, but it's not very gusty and it's fairly consistent. I've also got a power meter, so I can make sure that my average power for each time trial test run is the same. Now, if you don't have a power meter, it is still possible to do an aero test like this. What you need is a very gradual descent where you can just freewheel down and measure the difference in time. But it is better with a power meter because the movement of your legs actually affects your aerodynamic resistance. Another key thing is that I'm not going to ride this test full gas. It's not just because I'm lazy, it's also because I've got to do it at least 6 times, and talk more about repeatability later. Although I do have to do it fairly fast to make the test externally valid. External validity is another important concept. It means the extent to which the results of your experiment can be assumed to be true for other cases. For example, different people, different courses, or different times. Well, now when it comes to riding a bike, and specifically the effect of aerodynamics, we know from science that some differences are person and shape specific, i.e., sadly, what is faster for you might not be faster for someone else, or on a different course. That's kind of obvious if you think about it.
So what this means is that basically your experiment is unlikely to be externally valid, but that doesn't actually really matter because you want to find out if you're faster, not if anyone is faster. What it does mean though is that you need to choose a test course similar to the course that you're targeting or racing, whether it's rolling, flat, hilly, windy, calm. Make sure it's as similar as possible. Choosing the right speed is also really important for aerodynamic testing. That's because your aerodynamic resistance increases as you go faster. So if you do your test too slowly, you might not see any difference, even though you might actually have improved your aerodynamic drag.
Now we come to repeatability. For each angle of the aero bars, I'm going to repeat the test and do it three times. Why three times? Well, so that I can see any anomalies. For each setup, the results should be fairly similar, but fluky results or outliers are always a possibility, especially when you're testing out on the road. So if I do it three times, or even better would be five times, but we're a bit short of time, then I can see if one result is really different from the others, and that gives me a clue that something might have gone wrong with that test, and I can repeat it. It is important to note, though, that you should only discount results that are actually outliers, not just the results that you don't like the look of. Reliability might sound like repeatability, but it's actually subtly different. Reliability is about how much of an effect the variable you're changing has compared to the inevitable effect of outside influences and, of course, how accurately you can measure things. For example, I'm testing two different bar angles and I'm doing three test runs for each angle. Now, if there's more of a difference between the times for the same angle of bar, i.e. the same setup, than there is between the averages for different angles, that means my test is not very reliable. Or to put it another way, the difference between the two setups is smaller than I can actually measure, so probably don't need to worry about bar angle in that case.
Now, it's going to sound blindingly obvious, but you need to be able to measure your output variable. So in this case, the time taken for each test run. Now, I need to press lap in exactly the same point, the start and finish of each lap. That way, I can take the data file home and analyse it later and see what the numbers really said, and I don't have to work out averages while I'm riding along on the road.
While we're talking measurement, your choice of time trial test route is extremely important. It needs to be similar to your race course, yes, but not the same length. It should be shorter, because remember, you're going to have to repeat it three times for each variable. On the other hand, it also shouldn't be too short, because otherwise the slight differences in when you push the lap button on your bike computer will lead to quite a significant error compared to the total length of the time you're measuring. So here we are back at GCN HQ, and it's time to analyse the results of my aero bar angle experiment. So results are in. It was actually a 1.1 kilometre course, I'd like to point out. For 0 degrees, I averaged 212.33 watts, and the average time was 1 minute 47.67 seconds. And for 5 degree bar angle, I averaged 213 watts, and the average time was 1 minute 48.33 seconds. And looking at those numbers, one might assume that 0 degrees is faster. But hold your horses. I made some real mistakes designing this experiment. For example, there's more variation between the time measured for each setup. So, for example, at 0 degrees, the time measured varied from 1 minute 43 seconds to 1 minute 51 seconds. And for 5 degrees, the quickest time was 1 minute 44 seconds and the slowest time was 1 minute 55 seconds. So what you can see is there's more variation in time within the setup, so for the same setup, than there is between the two setups. So if there is a difference, it's so small that we'd have to do a statistically significant number of tests to work it out. And three is definitely not statistically significant. Secondly, that large variation within each setup is probably due to the gusty wind. So I could really feel the wind blowing me around while I was out there. And like I said earlier, you want to avoid the influence of wind on this kind of test. Well, I hope this video helps you in your quest for aero improvements. Give it a thumbs up if so, and share it with your speedy cycling friends. Don't forget to let me know down in the comments if you're setting up your own aero experiments. And if you'd like to check out another aero geekery video, there's this one about why size really is important.